as we talked through this morning, we are the seventh largest city in the country, as you know, and it's wonderful. But look at the other things about our fabulous San Antonio, ranking the fifth fastest growing city in the United States, ranking the sixth for 10 cities that are magnets for the millennials. And right now, the millennials are in the workforce along with the other four generations, but in the next 10 years, the millennials will be the major portion of our workforce. So we really do have to look at how we help our millennials move along. The city's been named the city of America's that people are flocking to. It ranks in the top 10 cities for startups by the Business Magazine, Facilities Magazine, and again, it's ranked as the seventh largest city in the country. Now, what does that mean for us in terms of workforce? Because we hear all the time, and especially as I chair the Alamo College's District Board of Trustees, we work with the business community as well as with the ISDs and other educational entities. So we hear from them all the time, please get the workforce ready for us. We have all of these jobs open, but we don't have the workforce ready for us. So we're looking at the technical skills as well as the essential skills. And that's what we hear from our employers. Notice that when a student enters the ninth grade and then what the job gap is and what the needs are in the workforce. But please focus on this one right here going across. Look at the majority of the jobs that are in that area that require an associate's degree, but not necessarily a four-year degree. But look at the percentage of those kinds of jobs that are available. So 40% of our population in San Antonio has a high school education or less, and we've got to start working on that. The diploma just isn't what it used to be when the majority of us went through school. Well, let's see what it says about the incumbent labor force. Please notice that right here, less than a high school education, 15% of our people in San Antonio. That's a high number for a city, especially the seventh largest city in the country. So we've got to work on that. My nails got it. We've got to work on this at the high school, the middle school, the high school, and the elementary level to make sure our students understand they have got to go through all the way through high school and then hopefully transform into some of the other areas of education. Then please notice that looking at the college, some college or an associate's degree, only 33% of our people in San Antonio have that type of credential. That needs to be much, much higher. And the same for the bachelor's degree at 37%. Other cities have larger associate's degree and four-year degree numbers. So that means we've all got to really, really work hard. Well, what does that mean for us now? This is 60 by 30 Texas. Now, this is not a new multiplication times table that you have to memorize. So math teachers, put it away. Everybody look at it and understand that in pre-K through 12, you've got the STAR testing, you've got the high graduation rates, the low dropout rates, etc. Well, in higher ed, the Division of Higher Ed Coordinating Board has said that in Texas, by 2030, so there's where the 30 comes in, 60% of people 25 to 34 years old need to have a credential past a high school diploma. By 2030, 60% of people ages 25 to 34 have to have a credential that can be an associate's degree, a certificate, a license, whatever, a baccalaureate degree, so that they will be a much more skilled workforce. And you can see the wages that then are earned in those areas. So we've got to really work on how do we get this to happen. Well, in years past, centuries past, decades past, we have worked in a horizontal fashion. We've been siloed, and I'm going to talk about that in a few minutes, because we've got to take that siloed horizontal model and turn it upside down and rework it. But first off, let's look at our industries here in San Antonio, our growth industries. And you can see them, but especially focus on these right over here in construction and health services. Now, we all understand the health services one. That's easy to keep remembering. But the construction one, I want you to think of more than a person out building a house, hammering with a hammer and hammering nails in. The construction industry offers all kinds of opportunities, from architects and engineers, part of the STEM piece that we're all working on, as well as project managers, people who are going to help run the finances of the construction industry. So there are all kinds of opportunities there for us. Now, I said we have the old system that we've all worked with. And along the way, this is what I've seen as a superintendent and a principal. It's not my fault. I didn't do it wrong. It's not my fault. So we point to someone else. We point the other way. Well, as a superintendent, I would hear from all the career people, all the business people, you know, Katz, if you just get all those kids coming out of high school where they can read and write and fill out an application, we could really work with them in the business world. And I'd go, okay, so I'd listen to that. And then we'd look at colleges saying, well, if they just, those high school teachers, and just get those kids ready in high school, man, we could really teach them along the way here. And then you go sit in the teacher's lounge at high schools. Yeah, you've been in those lounges, I tell by your laughing, right, man? And what do high school teachers say? Oh, yeah, these people right here would just get those kids reading on grade level and bringing all their work and being prepared to bring their books and their papers. And oh, man, I could really teach them. All right, go sit in the teacher's lounge at the middle school. Some of you been in there, you've heard what I'm getting ready to say. Well, if those elementary teachers would just get those kids ready, we can really take them in middle school and move them on. And then let's go to that teacher's lounge. You know, every elementary school has a teacher's lounge. And those fourth and fifth grade teachers are saying, God, what are those people doing down in that pre-K and K, playing around all day, not getting those kids ready for us to teach? All right. Pre-K and K teachers, stand up, please. Pre-K and K. Pre-K and K, stand. Stand, stand, stand. I want you to know it is not your fault. You cannot take the blame all the way around here. I want you to remember that we have them for only 7 hours a day in that factory called a school. And they spend all the rest of their time each day out of those 24 hours out with families and out in the community and up and down the street playing and with games and with everything and MTV and God knows what they see on the computers now and all the handheld devices. So it is not all of our faults, some of the things we deal with as our kids come to school. So we have to really work on those essential skills all the way up and down here. Now, what are those essential skills? Well, you know them. You're working with them. The work ethic, looking at critical thinking, being able to solve problems, all of that teamwork that we're talking about, and how we have to have people coming into the workforce that can work on teams and all. Fitting into the culture of a company. This is what the business people talk about over here. How are they going to fit into our culture? Because every business has a culture. Every corporation has a culture. Every one of your schools has a culture. And how do people fit into the cultures? How do we help students to be flexible and to look and see what are the values of this business? What are the values of this school? What are the values that I define in my classroom for my students each year? How do we co-define values that we want to live with for the next 180 days? So it's very important to look at how we align our values with where we're going to be and work. Voicing opinions, being able to voice different opinions and ask thoughtful questions. That goes not only for you as teachers, but for teaching students. Remember the higher order thinking skills of questions? When I was superintendent in Harlandale, it's HOTS, higher order thinking skills. Hey, stand up, Harlandalers. Stand up. Proud of the South Side. So we would say Dr. Katz has the HOTS for you teachers in Arlington. And that meant Dr. Katz had the higher order thinking skills model for you to use as teachers in your classrooms so that we can not just ask that lower level set of questions, but how do we move students through to evaluation and judgment and being able to voice different kinds of opinions and ask thoughtful questions themselves. Teaching them to be flexible and focused. You know, you've got to do that. How do we go back to our schools and become flexible during the day when something happens? How do we stay focused? My daughter is here, Mem Shea. Mem, would you stand for just a minute? Stand up, I want them to see you. I'm very proud mama. Mem is special agent for the Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms and FBI departments of our country. And so she's keeping us safe in here this morning. But she does this to the kids. Focus.
Focus.
Focus. So how do you get your kids' attention in the classroom? Some of them have to have focus on what I'm getting ready to say. Some of your, excuse me guys, husbands may need
focus.
Thank gosh, you may have to say that to your wives also. But we've got to be flexible and we've got to be focused. Also, be creative and innovative. That is a huge skill that we have to have in the classroom, in our schools, in businesses, and all the way through the different levels. Developing new work processes. Now, that is one of the new ones that has crept in to our essential skills that we have to look at in business and in life. How do we teach our kids using the HOTS, the higher order thinking skills, to get to that level of being able to evaluate processes, doing lessons learned on things, and to look at how to develop new and different processes, because we are a process-oriented society. Looking at taking initiative. You know that. You want kids that will take initiative. Even the little pre-K kids, you can already pick them out. The ones that are going to be the next teachers and the next principals and the next lawyers and so on. You can pick them out because they're already taking initiative in those directions. And then being able to offer presentations to coworkers and to superiors. These are what we used to call the soft skills. They are no longer soft. They are the necessary skills. They are the essential skills for success in our society. Well, let's look at what we were talking about a minute ago when I said the essential elements morphed into the TEKS over the last four decades. And so we have to look at working smarter and not harder as teachers, and how do we begin to develop our lesson plans using the TEKS by incorporating these essential skills with the TEKS and having students practice and practice and practice some of these essential skills using the TEKS to teach the subject area or to teach the discipline that you're working on. So we have to look at from pre-K through grade 16, how do we align our work? And looking at that, this is just an example of taking one TEKS at the pre-K, K-2 level, and then moving it through all the way through the high school level. And looking at how you get into higher level thinking skills with the verbs, And then filling in and working on the essential skills, what we just talked about a minute ago, and I reviewed you on that, so that the students are able to practice those. Remember, the project-based and problem-based learning is much, much stronger than the sage on the stage. You need to be the what? Guide on the what? Guide on the side. Instead of lecturing like I'm doing this morning, but I only had 45 minutes and I couldn't get you up and down the steps too quickly to do projects. But anyway, we've got to make sure that we are looking at how do we develop our TEKS and our programs and our plans so that we are the guide on the side. And we're helping to build the teamwork. And we're helping students to take initiative and create presentations and present the presentations in class. So now we see that job and college readiness are the same. It's the essential skills. And education drives the essential skills. So now then we have the convergence of looking at, instead of that horizontal, siloed time frame, looking at how we have vertical programs and work together. So let's look at grades pre-K through 3. Make some notes on this, too, those of you who are in this level. I've looked at what are some things that you can do to help develop the essential skills and to help practice those essential skills in your classrooms, in your programs during the year. So looking at this particular grade area and laying the foundation, of course, the STEM areas, such as looking at robotics, looking at engineering, looking at bringing in our STEM subject areas, and so on, will help build centers in your classrooms, the pre-KK in one area, and hopefully some of the other levels build centers also that are of interest. Looking at junior achievement programs. Now, we have Junior Achievement of South Texas, and it is fabulous here in San Antonio. Yeah, they have wonderful programs, they have wonderful curriculum. Now, I can already hear you. I know just what you're saying. Mention it to your friends sitting next to you. You're saying, I'm not giving up my kids for anybody coming in my classroom because I have to get those kids ready for the start of this, and I can't give up that time for them. I have heard that. I know. But remember, we're going to be working smarter instead of harder. So we're going to work smarter by bringing in the people from the outside, such as Junior Achievement, whose curriculum is aligned with the TEKS. And they can help reinforce some of those subject topics that you are teaching in your classroom with the TEKS. Then going along project-based and contextualized learning. We are talking about this at the college level. We are working to help our college professors understand you can't stand up and lecture all the time. The kids are going to walk with their feet and they're going to go to online kinds of programs and all because they want to be involved. They want active learning. They want it contextualized so that it prints up here and it imprints. They practice it. They work with it. They see it. They smell it. They blow it. They do everything with it. And it imprints up here. And then you have a better time of it's staying with them. So looking at contextualized learning, the learning center, bring in the business community. Kids want to know, well, why do I have to learn that reading and writing stuff? Well, bring in an attorney, and the attorney can tell them why they got to learn it, because that's what attorneys do, read and write, and present. So look at how you help your students understand that. Now, it's very important also for us to start showing our kids in the classrooms what kinds of credentials will earn them what kinds of salaries and wages. Because many times they don't have that conversation at home. And so I would always go into classrooms as a superintendent, unannounced, and walk through schools and in and out of classrooms. If you've been in Harlandale when I was there, I may have been in your classroom. I was just in Edgewood this last year on a consulting job working with special education programs and co-teaching programs at the middle and high schools, in and out of classrooms and looking to see how things are going. When I would go in to do a little special speech on being a superintendent and especially asking the elementary kids, well, what do you think a superintendent is? And you'd just be amazed at all the answers that I would get. They were absolutely precious. But guess what question they would ask me? Two questions. What do you think the first one is? How much do you make? Absolutely. And what's the second one? How old are you? How old are you, ma'am? You know, the elementary kids just speak from the heart. They're not as subtle and cool as the middle and high school kids who ask the same questions, but a little differently. So I would always tell them how much I made, and they'd go, wow, man, that's so much money. Wow. Now, I would always tell them how old I was, and they go, oh, man, that's old. And then I would say, now, let me show you on the board how I get to make this amount of money as a superintendent and how many years of education I had to go through to get there. So I would put my 12 years down from first grade, because that's all we had, first grade through 12th grade. See, I am an old lady. And then I would do my bachelor's degree, and then I would do my master's degree, and then I would do my doctorate, and it adds up to something like about 32 or 33 years in school. And they go, wow, man, that's so long to be in school. But we've got to help them start to see what staying in school will help them do to get good jobs and buy the things that they want. Meanwhile, the classroom teachers were all digging holes to China because of the questions they had asked me, thinking, oh, my gosh, I'm going to get fired for my kids asking her how old she is. But never, never. I always loved it. Now then, at the elementary level, you can see I've got you into the exploring level from pre-K through grade 5. So we're exploring things. We're doing lots of work in the classroom to explore, explore, explore. So again, at the 4th and 5th grade level, look at some inventories, interest inventories, and start to use those. I've put a bunch of them in your resource packet in the back, in the appendix. And they're really good. They're interactive, many of them, and you need to start helping your students to see what are those things that I need to look at in terms of that House Middle 5 thing here that I have to deal with in middle school and high school. So how can I start to look at and determine what my interests are in order to get to that point where we're going to be doing pathways in high school? And then the project-based and contextualized learning, career days. Look at having career days, and when you have the career days, be sure that the careers people are coming. You have prepped them and worked up what you would like for them to talk about, which, remember, is working smarter, not thank you. I didn't hear it. Smarter, not
harder.
Thank you. Prep them, and they will love to have a little prep page so that they can couch their comments to help you reinforce what you are teaching and the teaks that they can be reinforcing for you. And then bring in the business community again. You know, the kids need to know why they're having to learn all that mathematics and so on. We'll bring that in. Then we go to middle school. Middle school, we're going to be engaging the students now. We've been exploring a lot at the elementary level, so let's now go to engaging them. On field trips and business and industry speakers coming in. Again, junior achievement programs are fabulous for this, of helping you to reinforce the teaks. Job shadowing, when parents are going to take their children to work day, maybe give them a little something as a parent, send out something in your class newsletter. Goes to parents about here are things you need to talk about when you take your kid to work day. Interest clubs. This is where you're going to be looking at the House Bill 5 pathways and then start to look at how can we have some interest clubs at middle school that will help to promote the interest for the kids at middle school to be able to make better decisions at the high school level for House Bill 5. And you can see I just mentioned a few of them. Architecture, law enforcement, engineering, public service, those different kinds of clubs that the middle school kids will just love. Then looking at high school, we are now going to be into transitioning. This is the time where they are into the 4 years at high school. They're going to be doing things at high school and especially looking at the House Bill 5 pathways. So looking at your college readiness courses, your advanced placement courses that students can be in, the international baccalaureate programs, IB programs are fabulous, both of those for college readiness. Looking at dual credit, we have 12,000 students in your school systems working through the Alamo College's district earning dual credit. We serve 8 counties, not just Bexar County. We serve 8 counties. So we have students from Floresville and Pleasanton and Poth and all those little towns out there that need to have their children, their students, earning dual credit in the high school, and we're helping with that. But then we have 14 early college high school programs this year. And next year we will probably have 17. So the students come from the different school districts. I'll take Judson as an example, because Judson was the first one to put a building on our campus. They built an early college high school at Northeast Lakeview campus, and there are 500 students there, and in the 9th and 10th grades, they take the majority of their high school courses in that building. But they walk over for some courses on the campus at Northeast Lakeview. In the 11th and 12th grades, the majority of their courses are taken over on our campus, that they just walk over to the buildings, and one or two courses are taken at their high school facility. So that's an early college high school. The students are earning an associate's degree free. They don't have to pay a penny for it. And so that saves parents and students buku thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars where they earn their associates. Those are wonderful programs, and I hope your school district is involved with us with an early college high school. We have the Alamo Academies, which are fabulous. This is for juniors and seniors in high school. They work with, in these areas, those you can see the areas, and while you're reading them, they are working with Rackspace, with Toyota, with Lockheed Martin, with Port San Antonio, AGB, SAWS, CPS Energy, and all of our big corporations in town. They are working with them, learning the business, as well as taking courses from the Alamo College's district, earning college credit. And then the key to this one is that during the summertime, those corporations employ those students as paid interns. So they go to work, they have to have the work ethic, they have to show up, they have to have initiative, they have to go through all of those essential skills that we just talked about a few minutes ago, while they are being tested at the workplace. So when they graduate and the company says, we want to keep you on and send you to finish up with your bachelor's degree, these kids are coming out and graduating from high school with a job placement at one of these major industries, a 401k, all of their benefits paid for, at 17 and 18 years old. Is that not cool? And they haven't had to pay a thing for those courses. And most of these companies are paying for them to go on and either finish up their associates, or if they finish their associates through this academies program, they send them on to finish up their four-year degree. Lockheed Martin has just paid for one of our Hispanic girls to finish her master's in electronical engineering. All free. Now, isn't that not a wonderful thing? Only in this country can we see those kinds of things happen. And then high school DECA programs, Distributive Education Clubs of America, wonderful business type programs with local competition, state competition, and national competition. And you can see the rest of those kinds of things that you can do at the high school level. So now you've heard me talk about House Bill 5. Everybody has to know about it. Pre-K teachers, those of you who stood up, pre-K teachers, you've got to know about House Bill 5 now. Because you are working to get your children ready for those next levels to be able to go into pathways at high school. And you don't decide the summer of your 9th grade where you're going into the 9th grade. You've got to start deciding at the middle school level what those pathways look like to you and what interests you. So So you can see the five pathways: STEM, business and industry, public services, arts and humanities, multidisciplinary studies. Now, I said that we are changing all of our programs, courses, and so on at the Alamo Colleges District. And they're going to be labeled, which they are now, Alamo Institutes. You can see the six Alamo Institutes, and you remember what I just read to you about the high school pathway. You see any similarities? Mm-hmm. Nod your head so I can see you're still with me. All right, so let's go to the next one, and you can see the crosswalk. And she's showing us how your high school endorsement areas crosswalk with our Alamo Colleges Institutes. So now then, we're actually talking about a seamless program that we've been talking about for 30 years called pre-K through grade 16, and it has still been siloed. Now then, we're really approaching it and looking at it as a seamless program. Looking at where we are now with building the college-going culture, so with all of this that we just talked about, here's what we're looking at. We're looking at stackable, stackable, instead of siloed, that I showed you earlier. So down here, you pre-K teachers in the exploration area and elementary teachers exploring what we just talked about, you're going to help get ready because middle school is going to build on what you're doing. And middle school, same thing, engaging, building so that the high school people who are going to be in the transitioning into the two-year college or the four-year college and then on into careers will be all interdependent with each other. And we won't be doing this anymore and saying, it's not my responsibility. I didn't do it. It's not my job. That is no longer in our vocabulary. So it's how are we going to work together? And right here where I just said two-year college, we have an opportunity now from this last legislative session that has just been signed into law that community colleges will be able to offer baccalaureate degrees. So we are excited about that, and our first one will probably be in the nursing arena because we have two nursing programs. So look for the new developments over the next 2 years in those areas. And looking at all of this, well, you know, we've always said it takes a village. Well, folks, it takes a new village. It takes a village of lots of people that I've just described. And we've got to look at how do we involve our families in this project? Because remember those data points I gave you right at the beginning about so many families don't have even a high school diploma, much less any part of a college degree? Those are called our FTICs, first time in college students. And that's what we have so many of, and the majority of our students coming through our two-year colleges and even in our four-year universities, the FTICs. So there's not a conversation around the dinner table at home if the parents haven't either finished high school or had any type of college. They're not talking college talk around the dinner table at home. So that's where we have to start working at middle school and high school, especially with the families, to understand what colleges do, what they've got to do to get ready for college, etc. We've got to look at our contextualized learning and all. How do we work with our counselors and principals and other ancillary people at our schools to help us with the essential skills? And then the schools and the learning that has to take place. So it all means that being essential and being successful will rely on education. And I hope that you are seeing that this new village, we all have to work together. We have to join hands and help build from each level up, because each level is interdependent on the next level and the previous level and the next level and the previous and the next and the next. So if you leave here today with that in mind, saying, I've got to go and start really working, instead of sitting in the teacher's lounge and say, boy, if those elementary teachers would just get those kids ready for me in middle school, I could teach them. How did we go down from the middle school to the elementary and start working together as teachers to do that. We're actually doing that in the Alamo Colleges District. Can you believe that? Isn't that something? We are sending our people to the high schools to work with aligning curriculum. Can you imagine? We're finally all aligning curriculum. So that's the basic thing we should do. Yeah. Up and down in order to do the kinds of things that we need to teach the essential skills. So does this make sense to you?
Yes.
Oh, I didn't hear you. Does this make sense to you? Yes. All right. Now, I want to have some fun. I've been having fun, but I want to have some more fun. All right. Here's your resources. Please be sure you take this and you look at it because there's all kinds of good stuff in there. And as I said earlier, interactive stuff. So Sandra, would you come forward? This is Sandra Mora. She is with the Alamo Colleges District, and she is our administrative assistant working with the board. She has 9 of us charming, wonderful individuals to work with all the time. And I love working with her as chair of the board. So now then, we're going to draw for a fun thing, and Mem is going to help get it to the person. And the USB in your packet has the electronic portion of what I just presented. That's my techie stuff that just came forward. That's about the extent of my techie. All right, here's the first ticket. Stand up and come down very quickly. 285-064. 285-064. 285, come over. What level? Well, they're on the pride of the South Side. What do you teach? Robotics kit to take to her school and use it however you would like to this next year or give it to another teacher, whatever, but that's from the Alamo Colleges District. Thank you.